Stop using these fonts now. For decades, the web was filled with ugly typography. Boring, ugly typefaces, poor readability, and, well, Comic Sans. In this video, I'm gonna give you my list of fonts to avoid at all costs. These are the same boring old fonts that everyone's been using since 1995. The same year the first Toy Story movie came out and I drank my first legal beer. I'm also gonna show you how to choose fonts for your digital work so your content is always looking its best. My name is Mark Lassoff. I've been teaching coding and digital design for over 20 years. Over the past decade, almost 2 million people have taken my courses on development and digital design. Before getting to my list of funky fonts, I'd like to remind you to hit that like button and subscribe. I publish new videos about digital design, coding, and development on Mondays and Thursdays. So let's talk a bit about digital typography. Most people's understanding of type doesn't go beyond the font drop-down menu in Word. However, if you learn how to use type correctly, you'll almost always make better choices and in turn, better looking designs. There are actually thousands and thousands of typefaces you can choose from, which is one of the reasons typography can seem so overwhelming. Here are a few things you should consider when choosing a typeface. First, legibility. A legible font is easy for the eye to follow. The letter forms are distinct from each other. Legible fonts are easy to read at length, but tend to be less decorative. Check out these two typefaces. On the left is a decorative typeface. On the right, a highly legible typeface meant to be used as body text. Which is easier for you to read? Which do you think would be fatiguing after a while? Legible typefaces are distinct in three ways. First, they have conventional letter shapes. An A looks like an A. Second, they're generously spaced. Generous spacing allows your eye to proceed from letter to letter and word to word smoothly. When a typeface is tightly spaced, your brain actually fills in the space between letters, making the typeface less legible. Finally, legible typefaces have tall lowercase letters. Technically, this is known as X height. This makes distinguishing between letters with small openings like C and E easier. The second major consideration when it comes to typeface choice is readability. Readability is more about the choices you make with a typeface rather than the specific font itself. Here's an example of a typeface being used readably and the same typeface being presented in a way that's difficult to read. Obviously, the poor color contrast on the right affects readability. Aside from color contrast, you can assure improved readability by making sure you use typefaces that were intended to be used how you're using them. Don't use a display font for body text, or vice versa. Body text fonts designed for readability and legibility may not be impactful when set as large text on a poster or an ad. You'll also improve readability by leaving a ragged right side on your text. Force justification and poor hyphenation make your typography less readable. If you're serious about your digital typography, you can check out the JavaScript library Hyphenator for correct client-side justification. In addition to legibility and readability, you also have to consider the appropriateness of your typeface choice. There are several aspects to consider. Design intent is the first. Was the typeface designed to be seen from far away on signage? Or perhaps for reading long paragraphs. You can read up on the typefaces you choose if you aren't sure about the design intent. You also have to consider the aesthetics of the typeface. You have to use your judgment a bit here, but you can tell when a typeface has aesthetics appropriate for a legal firm or a children's book. Compare these two fonts. One has a juvenile aesthetic that may be suited to a children's clothing store. The other is all business and would be more appropriate for a law firm or an accounting firm. You can also consider the ornateness of a typeface. Ornate fonts with lots of flourishes and wide serifs appear old school and traditional. Thinner, tighter sans serif typefaces appear more contemporary. It's a fine balance between being trite with a font and being anachronistic. Don't use Comic Sans just because your written copy is funny. In fact, don't use Comic Sans at all. It's on our upcoming list of fonts not to use. Don't use lithos, for example, because your topic is Greek, and avoid using futura every time the future is your topic. Mood is also part of the aesthetic. Let's take a look at two more typefaces. On the left, the mood is energetic and dynamic. On the right, the typeface has a more relaxing vibe. You can probably imagine very different use cases for these two typefaces. All right, with that short lesson in choosing typefaces, now we're ready for the list of fonts you need to stop using. I'd like to know, what are your favorite and least favorite fonts? Which typefaces do you use all the time, and which make you a tad nauseous? Use the comments below to let me know. All right, so let's get to our list of fonts that you need to stop using. The first winner is Times New Roman. People seem to think because this is the default typeface on Word and in your browser, that it's what you should use. Unless you're the New York Times, let's skip this one. It's overused and says nothing about your design other than I'm just like everybody else, or I'm too lazy to choose a typeface, let's go with what Microsoft likes. Like Times New Roman, Arial is overused and it's a ripoff of the classic Helvetica typeface. You know Helvetica from the iconic typography used for the New York subway system and dozens of companies, BMW, Panasonic, American Airlines, North Face, Crate & Barrel, Toyota, and Motorola all use Helvetica. But Arial's not Helvetica, it's the poor stepchild of Helvetica, and that's a very 90s dated feel at this point. If you wouldn't use Vanilla Ice to create your theme song, don't use Arial as your typeface. Next on my list, BrushScript. BrushScript has been around for decades and supposed to look like the lettering was done with a paintbrush. It doesn't. Fancy looking display fonts with connected lettering just aren't a thing anymore. Nobody's impressed by difficult to read script typefaces. Just don't use them. Speaking of ugly display fonts, don't forget curls. I hate curls. Unless you're making a pink birthday invitation for a third grade girl's birthday party, don't use curls. Curls is like the typography equivalent of those candy hearts you see around Valentine's Day with messages like, love you on them. Sure, they're sweet at first, but too many give you a painful cavity, which is what you deserve if you use curls. A go-to typeface for a handwritten look is Vivaldi. Vivaldi is a tad dramatic for my taste. It makes everything you create look like a wedding invitation. The over-the-top serifs and flourishes in Vivaldi don't make the typeface look handwritten. They make Vivaldi the drama queen of typefaces. So unless you're actually creating a wedding invitation, let's avoid Vivaldi. Of the thousands and thousands of typefaces that have been developed, only one has been the subject of scorn on Saturday Night Live. You know it, you hate it, but for some reason James Cameron loved it. We're talking about the font made infamous by the movie Avatar. Yes, we are talking about Papyrus. Papyrus was a bewildering choice for the Avatar movie logo. This font was always ugly and unprofessional. I don't know what it's supposed to communicate aside from we've run out of good ideas. Let's hope that if Avatar 2 actually comes out next year, that Papyrus has lost its starring role. Next is Courier. Some people use this when they want a font that appears typewritten. Courier is old school awkward and should have disappeared with modern typesetting. Courier is a monospaced font, meaning all the letters are the exact same width. This feature is exactly what makes Courier look so dated. Modern computer-based typesetting is able to account for different width letters. A lowercase w and a lowercase I should not occupy the same amount of space, and Courier should not occupy any of your designs. Hey, while I'm on a tear here, we need to talk about Lucida calligraphy. I guess if you're making a poster for the PTA bake sale, you can use this one. It's supposed to look like calligraphy. I guess if you hired the world's worst calligrapher, the result would look something like Lucida. There are many better calligraphy fonts out there. Choose one of those. And finally, the one you love to hate, the typeface that is universally scorned and deservedly so, Comic Sans. Comic Sans is universally hated while somehow also being universally overused. This is another gem of a font from Microsoft. Comic Sans is different, and that's probably why it was chosen so much in the 90s, but I'm not sure it was ever appealing. Comic Sans has turned into a joke in the design and development circles. So please, save your own credibility and avoid using it at all costs. It might be okay for an 8-year-old writing grandma, but as a professional choice, it's a poor one. The thing is, we used to be really limited when it came to font choice, especially on the web. Due to the limitations of early HTML, we needed to choose common fonts because they would only display correctly if the user had the font file on their machine. So as a web designer, you never could be sure what fonts the user had. That led to using common, boring fonts over and over again. For print, typeface packages tended to be very expensive, so people stuck to the common, free fonts that generally weren't all that effective. Now we have type libraries where thousands of different fonts can be accessed. Adobe Typekit gives Creative Cloud subscribers access to all the fonts in their library. Google Fonts is free and provides access to a variety of different typefaces. Over the years, I found Google Fonts extremely helpful when I wanted to find and use new typefaces in my work. If you found this video helpful, don't forget to mash that like button and then subscribe and hit the bell. We're coming out with new content all the time, and we want you to be the first to know. I'm Mark Lassoff for Framework Digital. We'd love to have you as part of our community of folks learning digital design, development, and coding skills. When you sign up at frameworktv.com, I'll send you free courses, workshops, and projects to help you develop your digital skills. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.